Hello, everyone. You are at the right place if you are joining us for the live talkback of Waiting for Godínez. Hi, my name is Cherish Monique Duke, and welcome to SPF 12. Today, we are joined by our incredible director, writer, and the cast of Waiting for Godínez, which if you just saw, you must have laughed out loud at least 100 times because I know that I did. Today, we are joined by the incredible writer, Daniel Olivas, who's an award-winning author of 10 books and editor of 2 anthologies, including, I'm sure you're not surprised to know, a poetry book called Crossing the Border, Collected Poems. We also have Sara Guerrero, who is an incredible director. As you saw, she brought so much life to this piece. And she is the artistic director also of Breath of Life Latina Theater Ensemble, which is an award-winning theater ensemble out of California. So thank you all so much for joining us, our amazing writer and amazing director, and of course, our incredible cast, which brought this beautiful piece to life. Cast, would you mind introducing yourself to the audience and the characters that you played? And we'll start with Press.
Yes, thank you. Hi, my name is Presciliana, Esparolini, and I read for the role of Isabel in Chavalita.
Hi, my name is Richard Soto. I read for the role of Chuy, Jesús.
I'm Frank Collison. I was Piso Mojado. And for those of you who don't speak Spanish, that means wet floor.
Hello, my name is Rebecca Bermudez, and I read for Afortunada.
Hello, my name is Citlalli Sanchez, or Lalli, and I played the two children.
Awesome. And not here today was our incredible stage directions reader, Christine Jolie. So thank you so much, Christine, for reading and also narrating this story. So let's get started with our talk back, because I think everyone wants to hear from you, Daniel, not me. So can you tell us, and also for our audience, if you'd like to join the talk back, you can go to the Road Theater's YouTube channel. Just type in the questions there. Someone is going to be texting me the questions, so I'll be able to ask them directly to the authors, to the writer and the cast. So please go back to the YouTube channel and you'll see where you can type in the chat your questions. Okay, Daniel, this piece is based off Waiting for Godot, which is, you know, one of Beckett's most famous plays, probably one of the most famous plays in the lexicon. What did Waiting for Godot influence this piece? How did that come about?
First of all, thank you. Thank you to the Road Theater and the amazing actors and my director. They really brought this to life. For almost, let's say 22, 23 years before writing this play in 2019, I had written fiction and poetry and essays coming out of my experiences being a Chicano within this culture, and which also means I've dealt with the issue of anti-immigrant sentiment and bigotry. In 2018, I wrote a piece for the New York Times called The Dystopia is Here, where I explained how I used fiction to address President Trump's zero tolerance policy, whereby families were basically torn apart. It was a way to punish immigrants in probably the most vicious way possible. By 2019, this policy was in full reign with respect to border policy. And it reached a point in my mind that this type of bigotry was so absurd that the only way to really address it for me as a writer was to use the absurdist type of theater writing. And of course, Waiting for Godot is probably the most famous absurdist play. So what I did was I read the play, I watched many versions of it, and then it struck me. I knew exactly what my characters would be suffering day in and day out. And that's the plight of poor, you know, Chuy, being snatched up by ICE and thrown into a cage every single night, even though, as we learn at the end of the play, he was in fact born in the United States. I'm second generation. I'm the grandson of Mexican immigrants. I've been stopped by ICE. I've been questioned by ICE. So when you walk in this country with this color of skin, with this kind of look, this country would treat you a certain way. And so my play is a reaction to all of that.
How long did it take to write the piece? And is this sort of the first iteration, or have you written multiple versions?
So it took me 13 days to write the play.
Wow.
I taught myself how to write plays. I had never written a play. I have no MFA. I have a law degree. By day, I'm a government lawyer. But I was an English major, but I never studied writing. So my fiction, my poetry, and now my playwriting, I'm self-taught. So what I did was I looked at formatting, how plays are formatted. I'd always gone to plays since I was a teenager. I've always read plays. So what I did was I decided, okay, I know what the structure looks like. I know what a play is supposed to look like. I've been told by reviewers that I write very strong dialogue. And I just, for 13 days in the evenings and weekends, because I have a day job, I wrote this play. I completed the play in 13 days and started to submit it to theaters. And the first theater to pick it up was Playwrights Arena. And we did a reading of this play last year. After that reading, I expanded on the storyline, added about 14 pages. So it's essentially what was read today.
Wow. Wow. 13 days. Many playwrights would be very jealous that you just picked up writing and I was able to write an entire amazing piece in 13 days. That's pretty incredible. And I hope that you continue.
I'm old. I'm 62. So I wrote the play when I was 60, and I'm a lawyer. So I write for a living. I'm not afraid to write, and I edit, and I kill my little darlings, and I just do it. And I think, I don't think I have writer's block. I just write. So.
That's amazing. That's amazing. Sarah, I want to get into sort of the themes of the play. And for those of you that don't know, Sarah is an award-winning director. She's an incredible director. She brings pieces to life all over America. I've had the pleasure with working with her, and she's just incredible. And the movement that you brought to this piece, I want to start there. Just sort of bringing an absurdist comedy to the Zoom screen and the tools that you used. So can you talk about how you brought this amazing piece to this small screen?
Well, thank you, Cherish. Love seeing you. I want to say that when you read a script and when it resonates with you, and then there's a little funny tidbit or a little funny backstory. I was not going to direct anything on Zoom. I was kind of like, I'm done. And then I read Daniel's script. The road had sent it to me, and I was like, I got to do this. I got to do this play. I read it, and it completely resonated with me. I love Beckett. I love Waiting for Godot. I love absurdity. And to blend it with relevant topics, like dealing with immigration, perception, and then how time and the fatigue, and I think being in the pandemic, of what time meant, and thinking about, like, if someone's dream, you know, is ultimately just sleep, what does that mean to them as a person? The time, you know, the constant, you know, the way in which someone is treated, viewed, you know, held in detention, and then processed, and then that time frame, like, what is it? You know, it almost becomes very surreal. And I mean, going through the pandemic, I mean, my experience is, you know, being in my own personal space and working with people in these bubbles, but, and then reading what's going on in my community. I live in a community that was, you know, highly impacted by COVID in Santa Ana and Orange County. And we had the highest number of COVID people affected, you know, with numbers, but also just understanding what ICE means, what immigration means to a largely immigrant community as well. I'm also second generation. And as Daniel has spoken about having those experiences and people making assumptions, I mean, there's a great privilege in not having to explain your status, who you are, and were you born here, you know? And then just, you know, in the world of theater as well, also being exposed to that, people making assumptions. But again, the humor behind this, the lightness behind this, the also the issues, immigration, and not having a home or a place, and then just having the people that you that you're holding on to, we meet these two characters who have a history, and there's a sense of uncertainty, which has been constant in this time. So I think a lot of the themes that we see in this piece, I think if you, as we've gone through this pandemic, are very relatable. And then of course, I love, you know, Piso, Mojado, and Afortunado, the humor that they bring to it, you know, the literary agent who's looking to make a buck, who can't make a buck off of their poet. And, this piece resonated to me, with me personally. I decided to do one more thing on Zoom. And so, and it was such a pleasure to, because I had heard about this play and then finally got to read it and then get to work with Daniel, who's a generous, generous writer. And to his credit, the fact that you are not precious about things and willing to just try and be, you know, just that generosity. I love that in a room with a playwright. And then also being able to talk about and discuss the work, about what it means, and, you know, in his reasons for writing this play. So I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, no, that was wonderful. There's so many themes to unpack in this play, which made it just incredible to watch, because it was like, yes, I agree there. I agree there. I agree there. That's such a beautiful line. There were so many great lines. One of my favorite lines in the play, and this is a question for you, Press, is one of the things that the characters say is, bring me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses, yearning to be free, of course. And then one of the characters says, do not trust pretty words, but words matter. Words matter until they do not. You say a lot in this play, Press. You say you don't want mangoes, but then you have mangoes. And you get mangoes. You say you're going to look out for him, but you don't look out for him. You say you love him, but then, so there's so many layers to unpack. Tell me about this character of Isabella. Is she a liar? Is she paralyzed to do things? What did you get from this character? Because she's such a multidimensional sort of.
Yes. Yeah, she is very multidimensional. I think at the end of the day, like a lot of these people that I think Daniel is writing about are survivors. Mm-hmm. To do what they have to do in order to survive. And I think there's a part of me that when I see this child come back into my life, there is reflection back in time of where maybe she lost her children, or they had a separation at the border, right? It's not necessarily talked about in the play, but you can only imagine, since that's one of the themes, right? And so she saves what little she has to provide for this child, who may or may not be hers. So, is she contradictory in throughout the play? Yes, but I think it all has to do with survival. And she does it with humor. And she does it because she loves Jesus. You know, she does love him at her core, but she has to play with him, and she has to do what she has to do to pass the time in whatever realm that they're in, where there is actually no time, right? I mean, she has to find ways to keep it moving. So that's what I enjoyed most about her.
Yeah, the humor and the language, and you were so funny. It was just hilarious. And I just want to remind the audience that if you want to join in the talkback, or if you have any comments or questions for our cast and our writer and director, feel free to use the chat on the Road Theater's YouTube page. Okay, so Richard, Press brought up the comedy a bit, and I just thought, like, it was so funny. Your character's talking about the Daniel Jacob's Ladder Darius story was just hilarious and well written by you, Daniel. But it's just so funny because it's like, yeah, you could totally see Daniel being handed the Jacob's Ladder. That's a great connection. How did humor help tell this very important story, Richard? Like, how do you think this absurdist?
First of all, thank you very much. And I think to answer the question, I think humor is extremely important, given the fact that the subject matter is very it's a serious one. To be blunt, I rage, I seethe at what has been happening on the border. Mm-hmm. And I have an emotional connection to it because my brother is a retired Border Patrol agent. And we have a connection, a familial connection, but we have a philosophical difference, a major one. And the idea for me is that certainly any entity, any country needs to protect itself. It's not necessarily its borders, but it has to protect itself. That's why we have these enforcements. But there's a way to do that. And I believe the where I've come from is the humanity. And that's what is completely lacking in any approach to what has been going on down there. And in order for us to move forward, in order for us to educate and enlighten individuals as to the humanity of what is going on, we need to bring in the other facets of human beings, which is, it's not just anger, it's not just fear. We're a multitude of things, right? And so there's the humanity is brought forth through that humor to make it laugh, to possibly, just possibly get somebody to laugh and listen and go, oh, wait a minute. Oh, okay, I get it. And that is why the humor is very important. In Chuy's life, he's very childlike. He's very childlike. He represents the childlike quality all of us as human beings sometimes lose touch with when we start becoming adults and we start dealing with policies and we start dealing with law. We forget that, you know, I always, you know, I'm very childlike. They cast this perfectly, right? I'm constantly trying to figure out, wow, this is cool. My favorite part of rehearsal. And I'm so grateful for Daniel's words and for Sarah's direction is that my favorite time in rehearsal is the learning of this piece. I'm like, wow, this is, my mind is exploding. And then the challenge is, how are we going to make the audience's mind explode the way ours has been? Our hearts have been pounding doing this piece. And so for me, in trying to get the people to understand that there is so much to humanity. I and one of those lessons, I go out and I water my lawn and I go, oh, there's ants over in this area. So I get off. 2 days later, I'm looking and they're somewhere else. They're creatures. They want to live. They want to survive. And that's what we as human beings want to do. We need to stop looking at that border and we need to look at the larger picture and go, there's people moving all over the place. And we're creating it and we have to help ourselves. And by the very virtue that I'm sitting here pontificating, we need humor or people are gonna tune us out.
I think that's really true, Richard, because through humor, it means that if people are laughing, that means they're listening, right? I mean, so I just love this idea of, you're right. I mean, when you have humor, at least you're listening to the subject matter and you've been able to draw in so that we listen. And I think absurdist humor does that in a really great way because it's so over the top that you have no choice but to be like, wait, what did that really mean? What is that really saying? So you're right, Richard. I think it's really important to have that. And thank you for your pontificating because it's really interesting to hear your sort of personal connection to this. And familiar connection. Frank, I have to come to you because I think I just love this idea of Ponzo the slave or Piso rewritten in this way. What does Piso represent in this piece? I mean, is it the drive for money? Is it the total lack of regard for artistry? I mean, what did he represent for you when you were sort of working on this character?
Well, first of all, I'm not surprised that Daniel wrote this in 13 hours because at the rate he bills, it's probably pretty cheap. I have a connection to this play. When I was about Lolly's age, I saw it for the first time and I was most entranced by Pazzo and Lucky. My sense is that Daniel has some very strong opinions about the lack of respect that poets get, and that he used the opportunity to speak this his rage about this, and the fact that there is so little respect for the written word. My mother was an English teacher, and my father was a playwright. And when I would leave for rehearsal, he would lean up from his chair and go, "Respect the word." So I think that in the original, Lucky or Afortunada is a slave. And of course, I deny she's a slave now, but she really is. She's enslaved to a contract, like writers are, or they get sucked into being hack novelists writing novels that are only designed to hopefully be made into Hollywood blockbusters. So, but I just enjoyed the humor of it. I was in the Anchorage airport about a day after we rehearsed, recorded this, and there was a Piso Mojado sign on the floor. I think I photographed it and sent it back to you. I also want to say that the translation, the subtitles were a bit off, but my favorite mistake was when I said nom de plume, and they spelled it G-N-O-M-E. The gnome.
The gnome.
The gnome of the pen. The little gnome of the plume. What was your question?
No, I think you answered it, Frank. Yeah. I think you answered it. Like, what was the point of, what was the impetus behind the character? And I think you're right. It's about respecting the word and the lack of respect for the word, for the written word, especially poetry.
There's one question I want to ask Daniel, and you don't have to answer it now, but maybe when it comes time for the questions. If someone has never read or seen the original play, will they be able to understand this play? I know my answer is yes, I think they will. But I'm just wondering what Daniel's thoughts were on that. This may be messing with your order of the way you want to do things.
No, no, there is no order.
Anyway, okay. That was just my thought about it.
Well, so some people I know have never read or seen Waiting for Godot, who have seen my play and got it and enjoyed it. So that, you know, that's sort of like a test. But I do want to add one more thing about what Frank was saying. One of the biggest things I have seen in the publishing industry is racism and sexism, the same things we keep on seeing every place else, like the kind of bigotry that essentially allows white men to, and white women at times, to receive seven-figure contracts for books that perhaps are depicting the lives of brown folks or folks of color, other folks of color. And there's just this, again, absurdist element to the publishing industry that writers of color have been decrying. I wrote a piece for The Guardian a couple last year about the American Dirt novel, where a white woman was hired, paid seven figures to write a novel about border violence, and that Oprah Winfrey chose it for the book club, and it became a rather high profile fiasco, because as the great writer Luis Urrea said, no one ever pays a Mexican seven figures to write these books. Yeah, that's, maybe there's a little bit of anger in me when I created my wonderful Piso Mojado.
But what a great way to channel it.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. And I would say, hey, if this is an open conversation. So if anybody ever has, I'm going to ask questions to people, but if anybody ever has a question for their castmates or for Daniel, for Sarah, feel free to join in. This is an open forum. Rebecca, I want to come to you. Because I'm interested in this idea of, first of all, Daniel, someone in the chat actually had a question with these names. How did you come up with these names? Because you chose the name Godínez, and why do Isabel and Jesús have two different names?
Well, just like in the original, Waiting for Godot, Gogo and Didi are the nicknames. In fact, they never call each other you know, Estragon and Vladimir, which is what their names are when you read the names of the characters. And so Isabel is a name of my mother and my grandmother, and their nickname is Chavalita. And Jesus, well, you know, maybe Jesus, who knows? I mean, you think about how the country treats people who are considered foreigners. And so maybe there's a little message there, who knows? And I love the nickname Chuy, which is a nickname for Jesus. Afortunada means lucky, but in Spanish. And Pozo, which is the original name from Godot, from the Godot play, whenever I read the play, for some reason, I would think Piso Mojado. I don't know why, it just kind of came into my head, and I thought it was hilarious, and my Piso doesn't truly understand the meaning of his name, which I think is absurd and funny, and so.
Awesome, that's great. Rebecca, Lucky, Afortunada, why does the character stab out the eyes? Why do you think your character does that?
I think it's, at least for myself as an artist, I feel like there's a lot of the stress that can come into play. And we see how Afortunada is treated for the beginning of the piece compared to the new character that she jumps into. So I think it's that frustration of the fact that Piso Mojado, you know, it's technically talking all these negative things about her as being a poet, right? But I see her kind of adapting to the fact that, okay, you don't want a poet, poem is not working, then you want novelist, you want me to be an NFA player, you want me to be whatever you want me to be, I'm going to have to adapt to be, because in this industry, as artists, we just have to adapt, kind of like what we've been doing with Zoom, right? So with the whole thing of, okay, you don't like this, fine, I'll give you that, I can't necessarily bring out who I truly am, because I need to be what they want me to be. And so I feel like it's the pile of that, like, frustration, and maybe one of those days that Piso Mojado was just having, you know, maybe not being so nice and kind to Afortunada, who's doing all these great and amazing things for him and serving him and doing all this, you know. Maybe one of those days Afortunada just kind of lost it. But because they know that they work as a team and they're just great together, it's kind of those, oh, we forgive and forget kind of thing. Let's just move on. Yes, she took out my eyes, but it's okay. That was, you know, she's still going to give me money. So I think it was one of those frustration moments where she just kind of snapped and she finally just had it. But it was one of those moments that we just kind of forget. It was like, it's fine. It happened, but we're moving on.
Awesome. Great. And Lalli, who I think stole the show. You were so good. You were so good. Great job. How old are you, first of all? That's my first question, because you were so good and so just cute. How old are you, and is this your first Zoom play?
I'm 10 years old, which I just turned 10 years old in May. And this is actually my first play on Zoom. I did a reading in December. I made that with Sarah. But it wasn't technically a play because it was Breath for Breath of Fire. And I just did it myself, and Sarah helped, and my mom pitched in a little bit. Yeah, this is my first play on Zoom, and it was really fun. I love doing it. It was in the summer, especially, I have a little bit of a hard time because I miss my friends from school. So I do activities, and this was, I've done Olvidados, which I just did, but this was my first play, like, on Zoom, and my first real one, so it was very exciting, and I'm very glad I did it, and I'm just very glad Sarah said that I should be in it, so it was just a ton of fun.
Great, and do you act a lot? Are you an actor? Because you were so good.
Well, let's just say I act by myself in my room and a lot in other places.
We can probably all relate. We can all relate. I sing by myself and, you know, I try to not let anybody hear. So I understand acting by yourself. You just want to do it. I hope you continue because you were very good. You were really great. Excellent acting.
Thank you.
I have a question for the whole cast and anybody can answer this. This idea of Sisyphus pushing the rock up the hill and this connection to immigration and the journey to America. Can someone expand on that and talk more? Because Sisyphus was such a part of this piece. And I'd love to hear more about unpacking that. What is, yes, Richard.
I think that until this country actually comes to a reckoning with how it was created, who it's living next to, i.e. the Latinos south of the border, as it were, and comes to some sort of human resourceful way of dealing with what we need. People need work. Right, we bring people in, right? We bring people in, and we people get hired, and they go after the individuals, but they don't really go after the organizations that hire them that incentivize the whole thing. So until we deal with it, and for whatever reason, until we clean it up, it's gonna go on. Because right now we're talking about an administration right now where they're going, you know, it's not as good as you said it was going to be. It's like, yeah, but it's not as worse as it was before. But then someone's going to say, but what does that matter? It's still a bad situation. We have to come to a reckoning with the fact that we have been living next to each other and we moved the border on each other. And somebody said, you know, it's like for me personally, this is my personal thing. You can't say that we are one of the most significant countries in the history of the world. You can't say that and then come up with lame excuses of not being able to solve the problem. We've been kicking the can down the street for far too long. We've been burying our heads. And I think it's gotta be done. It's gotta be done. And that's what that whole represents. You know, it's that, we've got to keep pushing that rock up until we just get it to a ledge. There's no peak. There's no perfect. Get it to a damn ledge. Do something so it's not rolling down on our asses all the time. Excuse me.
No, well said. And anybody else want to join in that?
I was going to also say, I mean, just historically, I mean, the patterns that we continue to revisit. I mean, we think about repatriation from the 1930s, how immigrants were scapegoated and those who were born here were told, oh, go back to your country. It's like, well, this is my country. How can you say that this is not my country? And then also what people, you know, in other countries, they have this idea, they have this dream of what is the American dream. And they come here and then they're sort of labored with this boulder. It's like, let's blow up that fucking boulder. You know, let's eliminate the boulder. And it's horrific. I mean, just economically, you know, when we think about what racism has done to this country, like how it's made us more poor. If we were to, you know, work together and think about new ways in which we think about immigration, like just the process alone is just heart-wrenching. And this is not just the time, you know, this has been going on for so long. You know, we've all been pushing this boulder. If we don't think we're pushing that boulder up, we all are, you know, and if we don't make changes, like find that ledge or blow it up or let go of that damn boulder, you know, and free ourselves. It's such a bigger picture to this. You know, and unfortunately, I mean, even just thinking about how we are navigating with our health in this time, you know, with COVID, you know, with numbers going up, like we all have a boulder to carry. And it's like, wouldn't you be happier if we didn't have to? But it's really getting past people's biases and ignorance. You know, and then what's been set up politically and how people make money off of the border, how people make money off of these private prisons. There's so much. It's a big onion. I think that's the onion. The boulder's the onion with all those damn layers. Sorry. Anyway, it's a beautiful illustration, and I mean, and to Daniel's credit, and to this cast credit, I mean, just the conversations of unlayering and having these conversations about Sisyphus, about what does that poem mean, and when Presciliana's character asks, like, what does it mean, you know, and no one quite explains it, but you know, it's very apparent that they're all pushing up this boulder.
Let me just note that poem was in my collection, Crossing the Border. I wrote that poem. The poem appeared in a literary journal, and then it ended up in my collection, which is why I mocked myself within the play, where Piso says, you know, it's a poem by a minor poet, and he doesn't have a wherewithal to sue me if, you know, if we violate his copyright. But the reason why I wanted to include that poem in the play was because, you know, the concept, the existential concept of, you know, what does life mean when you're doing the same thing over and over again, and it keeps on resulting in the, you know, a horrible result, you know, and that's what we keep on seeing. This is what, you know, Richard was noting. We've seen this film before, you know, the way this country has treated immigrants, whether, you know, they're Jewish immigrants or Italian, Irish, you know, Chinese, any immigrant group. This country desperately needs workers, will use workers, and then when they're done, you know, get them out, you know. And there'll be laws that'll be passed. You know, the Chinese Exclusion Act, for example. Some of them are very explicit laws. Some of it is very explicit policy, not laws. You know, and to be blunt, the population the white population in the United States is getting older. And countries that have an aging population, we see this in Europe, desperately need an influx of younger people to keep the country going. And guess where the younger people come from? They come from other countries. So, you know, you can't have it both ways, mm-hmm. You know?
And the thing that I would like to piggyback onto what Daniel said is that the idea of a country surviving into the future, and not only surviving, but thriving, prospering, all you have to do is connect to the DNA of the individuals who are coming here, who are willing to put their lives and everything that they have at stake. That's a drive, an innate drive, a passionate living drive that says, teach me and I will make this country better, because that drive will be our next surgeon, our next scientist, our next entrepreneur. That drive is what makes, that's what the whole concept, I mean, people forget, this was supposed to be about, this country, right? It's gotta be driven. And it, you know, to those white people that are getting older, I say, you know what? Do you want it to exist? Does it, I mean, think of the rainbow. You know, it's like a prism. It's like a prism. We are being shown the different colors that exist within that white light. We are all under that same sun. And if we can just understand that together, we create the lights that let us see, we'll get somewhere.
Mm. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, and just piggybacking on that, a question that we actually had was, what is a theme? And I believe, Richard, you said it sort of perfectly. If you just see the lights that we all have, you know, and what people can contribute. It's not about just taking, it's about contributing. And every person that comes here is contributing something to the American lexicon. And that's what people forget. And so I think that was really beautiful. For the rest of the cast and anybody else can answer this, what is a theme that you would want people to come away with or a lesson that you got from this script that has so many different layers in it that you would want people to come away with? And anybody can answer this if you'd like. Yes, Lalli.
Well, my mom and her side of the family are completely from Mexico. And I've heard so many stories and from this. And my grandpa from my dad's side is actually immigrated over here. And most of my family from my mom's side has immigrated here. So I've heard so many stories of just how awful they were treated and how badly Mexicans were silenced. It was just, it was awful. So my dad's a history teacher, so he knows everything about this, and I get to hear everything about this, and it's just horrible. Like, my dad, my family can tell you how fast I can snap while talking about this, but it's just, it's awful. Mexicans were silenced for so long, and so many, a lot of books and stories about Mexican, like, borders back in the day, and sometimes even here now, what Daniel said, we mostly, Mexicans don't write those books or tell those stories. It's usually not the Mexicans most of the time. So I just heard so many stories of how awful my grandparents were treated. And I'm wanting to ask more questions before it's too late. So it's just horrible. I've seen and heard so many awful things about how awful and how racist people were to Mexicans the second they were here, the color of their skin, the how they dressed, what their traditions were. And it's sometimes it's still like that to this day. And just my mom has told me every time that I saw an ice truck outside of their house, my aunt and uncles had to hide in a closet so they wouldn't get deported so they wouldn't be taken away from their family. So just hearing that got me in chills. It scared me. And in 2000, like when Donald Trump was announced president, I cried and I was 6 years old.
Lalli, what message would you have for kids your age? What would you tell them? What message would you give them if you could? Kids your age that may
ask
not
know. Ask questions if you have that possibility to ask questions. It's so important to learn this stuff and to hear this stuff and to make sure you tell somebody or ask somebody. It's a good thing to ask and try to figure out why, just how awful sometimes things can be and how you can change that sometimes.
Yeah. I think that's a great message. I think so many people don't know, like you said, like so many people don't know the history and so many people don't know what's going on, which is why plays are so essential. And which is why what we do at The Road is so essential. It's why you actors coming together to tell this story is so essential, because you've just educated all the people on this line and made people think in a different way. And that's what art really can do. And so I think it's just wonderful. You're right. You've got to tell the story because nobody knows. Everybody lives in their silos. So you've got to speak it. And then let people.
And sometimes even Mexicans don't know, like my generation or my mom's generation of Mexicans don't even know this happened. Because many people just don't tell these stories and they need to be shared.
Yeah, totally agree. I love that. Thank you. And the child, what is it saying? The little child will lead them. I think that's one of the Bible quotes. Well said. Well said. Parents are doing a great job. Parent award goes to them. Okay. This is going to be our last question because we're almost done with our talk back. This last question is just in a one word answer. And we're going to end with you, Daniel. So everybody just give me one word. What is one word that you would want people to come away with after seeing this play or from your character? What is one thing that you would want them to come away with? Just one word. And we'll start with you, Rebecca.
Empathy.
Good one. Frank?
Endure.
Oof. Definitely empathy, endurance. Okay. Press?
A little bit longer, but love is never lost.
Love is never lost. Richard?
Humanity.
Humanity, yes. Empathy, yes. Humanity, love, yes. All of these words, yes. Lalli?
Amazed.
What did you say?
Amazed.
Amazed. Okay, great. Yes, amazed by this script. Sarah?
You stole my words. I was like, I'm going to go with this one. Definitely empathy. I have to echo that, empathy. Resilience.
Resilience, yes. Daniel?
One, as in we are one.
Empathy, resilience, we are one, love. All of these words are incredible. And I think, Dan, you did an amazing job of making me laugh out loud, but also making me feel empathy and love and connection and resilience and oneness. And so thank you for your words. And thank you for participating and letting the Road Theater do your piece, because we all learned something. So thank you. And thank you, actors, for bringing your talent, and Sarah for bringing your direction. Daniel, I think you have a new, I read on your website that you actually have a new book coming out, How to Date a Flying Mexican, New and Collected Stories. When will that be dropping? So we can just...
So that'll be published by the University of Nevada Press next year, probably spring. And basically I've chosen my favorite stories that have been published over the last 25 years. And it's named after the story that my late father, who passed away last year, his favorite of my stories, because How to Date a Flying Mexican is a magical realist story about love. And it made him laugh so hard. And he said, but it's a truly Chicano story. And so that book is dedicated to my father, who passed last year, but who is still with us. Presente. Yeah.
Love. That's beautiful. So we'll definitely look out for that. The book again is called How to Date a Flying Mexican, New and Collected Stories. So thank you. And Daniel, I hope you keep writing, because if this is your first one, I mean, geez, Tony Awards down the line. I mean, Writers Awards, let's keep them coming. We need them, and the Road, you know, needs to be doing them. Just a thank reminder you. To our audience, this is a fundraiser. So if you could, and if you have it in your heart, please take a moment to go to the Road Theater's website, roadtheater.org/giving, to give to our theater company. You know, theaters were closed for a very long time, and some of them are still closed. We could use your funds. Any amount would be a great help and a great boon. So please consider donating to the Road. And this is the last play of our second week of SPF, but next week we have our third and final plays. You know, I'm so sad it's coming to an end. It feels like it goes past fast, but next Thursday, 7:29 at 6 p.m., we have a play called A Day of Saturn by Leviticus Jelks. And it's directed by Melissa Coleman Reed, another amazing director here in LA. And it's a play about loss, humor, Black masculinity, and the generational scars that follow us through life. So great, great little setup. Come back, come see Day of Saturn. Come see all of our plays next, week for our final week. And again, thank you for joining us for the live talkback of Waiting for Godínez.
Thank you so much.